very much. Can everyone hear me at the back? Yeah? All good? Thank you. Okay. I'm being a little bit facetious with the title, right? So I apologize for that. I've been working with sovereign and super funds for about 2 decades, which is embarrassing to admit. 30 minutes is probably not a lot of time, but if you do have any questions or comments to make through the presentation, please do. And there is time for questions at the end. Can I get, the lights have come down, it's a bit hard to see you guys, but can I get a show of hands who currently has a self-managed super fund in the audience? Oh, good number, okay, fantastic. And those of you who are thinking about one? Okay, great. So the content I'm going to talk through today will ideally help both of you as groups. For those of you who don't currently have a self-managed super fund and are not thinking about one, this may confirm your current decision or it may change it, depending on which bits you focus on, I think, more than anything else. You'll also be very pleased to know, please go and see a financial advisor if you're confused about anything or if you'd like specific personal advice. You'll be very pleased to know, oh goodness, okay. Very pleased to know there are no pictures in this whole presentation of very genteel-looking older couples wearing linen on a boat. Because that is the picture, that is the picture you must have in a self-managed super fund advertising material or content of any description. We've gone mad this time and done something completely different. So the things that we'll go through today, I apologize, I'm holding two bits of, I forgot to wear something that I could attach my mic to. So what is a self-managed super fund? Sounds like a simple question, but for a few people, it's worth articulating exactly what an SMSF is and what it exists to do. What are the benefits? What are the disadvantages? There are many on both sides. What can an SMSF invest in? This is a great question. I love it. And then we're going to talk about what SMSF trustees actually do invest in, because there is a dramatic difference between those two things. The averages are quite interesting to observe. There are very strict legislative caveats about what you can and can't do in an SMSF, right? So walking away today with an understanding of what those caveats look like is really, really important. Don't get those things wrong. There are very, very specific opportunities that do exist within a self-managed super fund that don't exist in a public offer fund. So they are different. You will come across people who tell you that you can do anything in their fund that you could do in an SMSF, and it's safer and easier and cheaper or whatever it might be. That's not really true. There are things you can do in an SMSF that are unique. Whether or not you need to do them is another question, right? There are a few people who can't or shouldn't have an SMSF. We're going to talk about who those people are just to ensure that you've ticked all the final boxes if you want to go down this path. And any key considerations if you're going to take this path, or you're already there, there are some issues that even existing trustees sometimes have not covered off. So we'll talk about what they look like. So again, no older couples on a boat. What is a self-managed super fund? It's a trust structure, probably the most important thing. So it is a trust structure that is governed by the superannuation legislation, the Superannuation Industry Supervision Act. And it is designed to hold your assets or the assets of the members for the sole purpose of providing for the members' retirement. So we love to say, if you only remember one thing from this presentation, right? Everyone will say that in their presentation. That second point up there, I've got a flashy pointer, here we go. That is the one thing that should be at the center of your mind when you consider a self-managed super fund. If you're in a public offer fund, and by public offer I mean a retail fund, a corporate super fund, an industry fund, whatever, any other fund that's managed by other people. If you're in a public fund, the board of trustees, and there will be a board of trustees, their job is to manage your assets for the sole purpose of providing for your retirement. If you have an SMSF, you have the same job providing for your own retirement. It's a bit confusing because you are both the trustee and the member, but the job is the same. The regulator for this particular part of the industry is the ATO. So for big funds, it's APRA. For self-managed super funds, it's the tax office. They have quite spectacular data these days, which is always a little bit nerve-wracking. They've got great data. And they provide a lot of guidance around how the legislation should operate in reality. And in that, they tell us what they consider to be managing to this sole purpose test. I'm going to give an example here, which I think helps many people understand this one. Anyone here ever have Myer shares when it had a 10% discount card attached to it? Yeah, little ripple. This is a younger crowd than some of the other states I've been in, so it may not be familiar with you. But back in the day, Myer, when you bought a Myer share, once you had 1,000 shares, and funnily enough, their register was full of people who only owned 1,000 shares, you would get a discount card, which would give you 5% off at Coles, when it was Coles Myer Group, and 10% off at Myer when everybody shopped at Myer. The ATO, after some years, came out and gave guidance that they would not permit, or it was not their belief, that SMSF trustees should be able to use that card. Because in that, in their view, whether you're retired or you're in accumulation phase, using that card gave you a current benefit when the shares were supposed to be held for providing for your retirement and no other purpose. Does that make sense?
So, I'm glad
those things are not happening. So, look, many people disagree with the ATO on many things, and you're very welcome to disagree with them, except that you often have to disagree with them in court and it's very expensive. So that was their view, that you could not use the Coles Myer card if the shares were held by your super fund. If you held them in your own personal name, use the card to your heart's content. So that gives you an idea of how the ATO views that sole purpose test. There are people also who take the view that if you are currently in retirement phase, you can use the assets of your SMSF to provide a current benefit, such as going and staying in a property owned by your SMSF. The ATO does not agree with that view, right? So you can disagree with the ATO, but you have to go and fight them in court if they decide to fine you or make your fund non-complaint. So that's the ATO's view. They're very clear. All of the assets of the fund have to be held for the purpose of providing for your retirement and no other purpose. Sorry, there are two ancillary purposes. One is providing death benefits to members in the event that one of the members passes away. So this is why you can hold life insurance through a self-managed super fund, and also to provide disablement benefits in the event that one of the members is incapacitated. So this is why you can hold TPD and income protection insurance through an SMSF. And finally, this is really, really important. Trustees are responsible for all activities of the fund. So whether you have a financial advisor, an accountant, an administrator, you get advice from somebody, or you do it all yourself, ultimately you are responsible. Two ways this plays out. One is that there is no statutory protection for SMSF trustees in the event that any fraud occurs on the account. So there is a statutory protection fund that exists in the event that there is fraud on a public fund. It happens very rarely in the super space, like big funds, very rarely an issue with fraud, right? But in the event that it does occur, it's happened once or twice in history, there is a statutory protection fund that all other super funds contribute to that will then compensate those members. That doesn't exist for SMSFs. The other thing is that if anything occurs, you can be held responsible being both fined by the tax office and then also having your fund made non-complying, which is a completely different set of taxes that are applied on your fund. So the consequences of your fund not doing what it's supposed to do under the law are very, very severe. I have a horror story on this one that I like to tell at the beginning of presentations just to upset everybody. No, it's just important to understand just how seriously they take this. This case comes from the Administrative Appeals Tribunal as well, so it's both the tax office's view and the secondary court to which people go if they're not happy with the tax office's view. So this particular situation, there was a couple, an older couple, who were members of a super fund, an SMSF, obviously, and they brought in their son as a third member. So you can have up to four members. They brought in a third member. Most funds are mum and dad, right? So most funds are two. The average number is about 1.9, but it's weird having 0.9 of a person, so let's say two. In this scenario, they brought in their son as a member of the fund. He was also a trustee because all trustees must be members and all members must be trustees unless you have a corporate trustee. And it turned out he was a drug addict. Now, the parents were not aware of that, obviously. And the fund was depleted of all its assets, by which I mean the son went and withdrew all of the assets. The money was obviously lost. They couldn't recoup it in any way. The tax office were made aware when the auditor did the first audit on the fund. and the tax office made the fund non-compliant. They also hit the trustees with penalties. So the trustees, the mum and dad, went to the Administrative Appeals Tribunal and said, we have nothing, right? We have nothing. We've lost all of our money. Our son has taken everything. We can't pay the fines. We would ask for leniency. It's the nicest way of putting it. We would ask for leniency. And we would argue that we were not responsible in this situation. And the Administrative Appeals Tribunal upheld the original decision. So their decision was, we understand your situation. It's heartbreaking. Obviously, this is terrible for everybody. But we cannot have this happen. And we do not want to set a precedent that people can not meet their obligations and not take responsibility for the activities of the fund. And therefore, all of those fines and penalties applied. So very much worth knowing who is in your fund and what they're planning to do with the money. The regulators take this stuff really seriously. I will say that is one case out of, there are 600,000 funds in Australia now, right? So it's really important to know 600,000 funds, those cases are incredibly rare. They're just heartbreaking when they do occur and everybody's situation is different. So it's worth being aware if your situation is a bit different, that this can be a complex scenario to be in. There are awesome benefits to being in an SMSF after I've told you how terrible things can be. The reasons that people set one up are almost consistent every time. More investment control and more investment choice are the two big ones, right? So the list of things you can invest in is really extensive, and the timing of when you invest in things and the way that you invest in them is entirely up to you, with a few caveats that I'll talk about. Anyone want to guess what the number one question I get is when I start talking about this stuff? Not crypto, but I like it. Not cryptocurrency. That is a new one. I have not had that too often so far. Any other guesses? Well, yeah, no, not that one. So the one that I get the most is, can I set up a fund and borrow to buy property? That's number one. And number two is, can I set up a fund, borrow to buy property and develop it? Is number two. So that is the thing that people are most excited about at the moment when they talk about setting up a fund. The second question, the answer is almost invariably no, which I'll talk about, and I'll talk about why in a minute. But borrowing is something that people are very excited about. Far few people do it. Far fewer people do it than want to do it. So once they understand the limitations, they get a bit less excited. But it appeals to people. This idea of one fund for the family is really appealing. So my husband and I set up a self-managed super fund. We thought about it for a long time, so it took us about 2 years to make the decision and do it. And my experience talking to other professionals in the area is that's not uncommon. That's pretty normal. And we enjoy the process, right? It's fun for us because we're boring people. have a glass of wine, talk about what we want to invest in, can't touch it for 20 years. Yay. Well, we're not divorced, so that's... Yeah, so divorce is a real issue. The question down the front is, what about divorce? Divorce is a real issue. If your relationship is not stable, I would not recommend a self-managed super fund. You can still, or not with the person you're planning to get divorced from. You can still have a self-managed super fund with someone you're not married to, right? If you separate, you can still maintain the fund. You can roll the funds out into other ones. It just gets costly, but divorces are costly with any kind of structure. Yeah, not ideal if your relationship's a bit shaky. That would be probably suggestion number one. There are potential tax benefits to an SMSF. Really important to know. So people talk about tax benefits for an SMSF. Super funds, all of them, whether SMSFs or public funds, are governed by the same legislation. So the legislation is not different for SMSFs. They don't have special tax concessions attached to them. What is most beneficial is timing. So if I have a $10,000 contribution I've claimed a deduction for going on in the 1st of July to a public offer fund, they will withhold 15 cents in the dollar, so $1,500 on day one if I'm in a big fund. If I have an SMSF, I have $10,000 working for me from day one, and then I put in my tax return like a year and a half later, and then I pay any tax that is subsequently what the fund is liable for after deductions and everything else after that. So I've had $10,000 working for me for a year and a half that somebody else would have only had $8,500 working for me. So that's one example where it can just be a matter of timing and a few other things. But legislation's the same, but can work a bit better because you're in control of everything in it. Potential cost savings. So this one depends in many cases on the size of the fund. If you have a very small fund, you will probably not save any money. An SMSF could be very, very expensive for you. If you have a really large fund, it could be really inexpensive. Just depends on how you manage it. Also depends on who you employ to do various elements of the work for you. Talk about that later. And then finally, business owners and commercial premises. So NAB has the biggest business bank in the country. It's what we specialise in. And we did a survey of our customers. 55% of them had an SMSF in business bank. So many business bank customers will have an SMSF, or business owners will have an SMSF, partly because they have this natural tendency to wanting to do things themselves, right? And partly because there is this opportunity to own commercial premises in a particularly attractive way. Disadvantages. I feel like I've played this one up enough. Anyone like me to talk more about this? You are responsible, right, for what happens, and there are penalties that apply if you do the wrong thing. If you do the wrong thing deliberately, there are very severe penalties that apply. If you do the wrong thing by mistake, you better fix it pretty fast and you still may be liable. It takes time and money to operate, and the regulatory environment for super funds in general changes all the time. It's kept me in a job for a long time, so you know I'm not going to complain too much about it. But it does change. We had the $1.6 million cap come in last year. The contribution caps change. We had RBLs 11 years ago. You know, things change all the time, and keeping on top of that can be quite difficult for some people. And if you are not employing professionals who are great at this stuff, then you need to keep on top of it yourself. This one is really interesting to me, this investment research, selection and execution. I'm talking to a room full of people who paid money to spend their Saturday learning about investment, so I'm guessing that isn't the worst bit for you guys. You're actually okay with it. But other people, they don't love it. The thing that my husband and I found interesting was we are great at research, we are great at selection, we are great at talking about investments, but getting our act together to actually put in the paperwork or execute the trade, that we were not so flash at. I would say, did you put that trade on? And he'd be like, oh, I thought you were going to do it. So make sure you've got the execution component wrapped up as well. That can be quite important. We're good at it now, but it took us a while. You know, when you're used to somebody else doing it all for you, sometimes it takes a bit of time to get it happening. We've got a long time frame, so we didn't have to worry too much. The other thing is cost tends to be fixed, right? So there is a flaw in your cost structure because there are ATO and regulatory fees that must be paid. You will probably have some accounting fees no matter how much you try to do yourself. You must have an independent auditor and so on. So there are these fixed fees that you must pay, and then layers on top of that if you wish to employ professionals in various areas. And so the more layers you add or the more sophisticated the professionals you employ, the more it will cost. So you need to think about that and whether or not it's cost effective for you. Like any other investment, there are risks, right? I think I've probably talked about that. If you get the right people, those risks are not necessarily enormous. So ensuring that you have the right specialist can make a really dramatic difference. I do employ specialists in mine, just from some of the administrative perspective. I don't love doing admin, nobody does. So I get good people to do mine for me. Let's talk about what SMSFs can invest in. Okay, so cash and TDs, that's not a surprise to everyone. An SMSF must have a cash account. Sounds like a really obvious statement, but it must have a cash account that with a hub of where everything goes in and out. So you must have a cash account. Term deposits, very popular. We're going to talk in a minute about where SMSFs actually do invest their money in a minute. Listed shares, unlisted shares. The caveats, I won't go into too much detail about these. They're not that common in a room like this. But the caveats that apply tend to relate to related parties. So there are very strict rules around where you can have a related party of the fund interacting with it. So if you have a private company of which you're a director or your brother's a director or whatever, then you're going to end up in problems with that one. So unlisted shares tend to be completely unrelated, private equity type stuff. Direct residential and commercial property also permissible. The caveats apply primarily to residential, which we will talk about in a minute. Managed funds, totally permissible. Other listed assets, so ETFs, hybrids, anything along ETMFs, there's a whole lot of new structures coming out now that you've seen. This is where it gets really fun though, right? Bonds, units in a private unit trust, gold, artwork, antiques, vintage cars, wine, anything that looks or feels like an investment that will provide for your retirement, back to the sole purpose test, is theoretically the kind of investment you can hold in an SMSF. There are people who have expertise in antiques who will invest very carefully for their retirement through antiques because that's their area of expertise. However, we all remember sole purpose test, right? Must be held for the sole purpose of providing for your retirement, and you cannot get a present day benefit from it. So you cannot have those antiques in your home. And no related party of your fund can have it in their home either, so your brother, sister, aunt, uncle, kids, whomever, they can't use it either. I've got a couple of lovely stories about this. A former colleague of mine who is one of the great SMSF specialists and has been doing this for a very long time, has explicitly stated that his goal, and he puts this on his biography, his goal is to have his SMSF with a top-class wine collection as its primary investment. And his secondary goal is to pay himself a pension in wine. He's fully aware you can't do that, by the way. but that's his goal. He's working on the ATO, hoping they'll change their mind. He also tells the gorgeous story many, many years ago, possibly many decades ago, of a jewellery dealer who had an SMSF. And the ATO did want to talk to her because she had extraordinary amounts of jewellery in her SMSF and no other assets. And they're like, about this one. So they asked her, look, theoretically jewellery is a legitimate investment. And she said, yes, I am a jewellery dealer. This is my area of expertise. I know these assets are going to increase in value before my retirement, and that's what I'm holding them for. And they said, fantastic. Just want to make sure you're following the other rules. Where do you keep it? And she said, oh, darling, I'm wearing it. So, not so keen on that answer. That one wasn't too good. So just remember the caveats, right? And go and put it somewhere else, not in your house, not on your person. Artwork's a good example. People can own artwork in an SMSF. Art dealers obviously would think about doing this, but you would have at least to a gallery. And showing in a gallery, you're receiving an income, you're not using it for a present day benefit. It's clearly going to be a proper investment in that capacity. A vintage car, if it is leased out to a wedding hire car company or something like that, and you don't go driving in it, happy days. Your super fund may be able to borrow to acquire these assets subject to strict requirements. A lot of people talk about this, that the borrowing legislation was originally only brought in for shares. And it was originally brought in because the ATO decided that instalment warrants would not be permissible in an SMSF. It's a bit of a problem since every single SMSF in Australia had Telstra warrants from when they were originally listed. So T1 and T2. T2 in the instalment structure was in every SMSF pretty much, and the ATO said you can't hold that anymore. So the government legislated rather than try to get everyone to sell their Telstra shares. Wouldn't have been ideal for anybody. The legislation, however, comes with an explanatory memorandum, and the original explanatory memorandum relating to borrowing for super funds, it's for super funds in general. Right? Any super fund theoretically can do this, but SMSFs are where it's actually done. Had three examples. Equities, the obvious one. Property. And artwork was the third. So anyone who tells you that they didn't know that people could use it for other things is clearly, didn't spend their boring time reading the explanatory memorandum to the legislation. This is what super funds do invest in, right? So this is interesting. It is averages. So averages can be misleading. There are 600,000 funds in Australia, as I mentioned. There's 1.1 million people who are trustees. Listed shares are the primary asset class that people are invested in. This comes from the ATO data. I'm sorry, I don't know how to fix my own presentation because they PDF'd it. I'm stuck now, so the attribution's fallen off. But this comes from the ATO data. It's a year or two out of date, but it tends not to change very much over time, right? So you will see these splits pretty consistent over a decade or more. Cash and term deposits, very large. So between listed shares, cash and term deposits, and listed trusts, which would be ETFs and similar and REITs and this sort of stuff, make up an enormous proportion of SMSFs. There are many SMSFs that just really have cash TDs and listed securities and nothing else. Private trusts tend to be property related, so people setting up property arrangements, and that's the easiest way for them to structure the acquisition. You will see residential property there at 5% and commercial property at 11%, which is not what you usually see. There is a reason for that, and that is the legislation is far more generous in its treatment of commercial property than residential. Managed funds are a pretty small proportion, so SMSF trustees don't love managed investments. They're increasingly enthusiastic about ETFs and other assets that give them diversification opportunities. So you can also see a tiny, tiny proportion of international shares, 1%, less than 1%, I think, I had to round that up. That is direct international shares, so obviously SMSFs get access to international equities in other ways by buying LICs listed in Australia, for example, that only hold international equities. But even so, even if you add up pretty much every other place you could find international equities on this list, it's going to be a small proportion relative to a big fund. Australian Super, which is the biggest super fund in Australia, currently has a 35% allocation to international equities. SMSFs have maybe 5, maximum 10. Yeah. Oh, so that's the total proportion of assets of all SMSFs invested in each of these asset classes. So there is $700 billion in all of the SMSFs in Australia added together, and this is how they, on average, invest. Does that make sense? Sorry, the question was, what do the averages mean? Is the average of all SMSFs, the ATO takes every single fund return, every single tax return, and goes, this is what they're invested in on average. Does that make sense? So you can see that SMSFs are very different to the average fund, very different. LRBA, in case you're wondering, is a limited recourse borrowing arrangement. That is the gearing arrangement that I talked about. So that's the borrowing to invest component. It's a relatively small proportion of assets that's been growing quite quickly. Talk quickly about the caveat. So I've probably overplayed this one already, but I'll go through it. Sole purpose test, yeah? Must be held for the purpose of providing for retirement, even if you're in retirement. If you want to do things with it for your own personal purposes, get that asset out of the fund before you start playing with it. Residential property is the obvious one. So the number of people who want to borrow to buy an apartment at the coast, some sort of residential investment property, and then let their kids live in it, go and stay in holidays, that kind of stuff is extraordinary, right? That is not permissible under the legislation. So that is a present day benefit, you cannot do it. And they make this clear in the related party arrangements as well. So family members, it's quite an extensive list of family members, it's not just mum, dad and kids, associated trusts and companies and business associates, there's quite an extensive list in the legislation of who falls into each of those categories to ensure that you're not setting up tricky arrangements to provide yourself or someone you know with a benefit from your super. You must treat it like it is an investment and an investment only, right? So there's a sole purpose test. In-house assets is where you're effectively providing a benefit to a member or related party of the fund, so there's a restriction on that. And you also can't acquire assets from related parties of the fund. So if you have an investment property and you would like to move that into your SMSF, unless that's a commercial premises, you can't do it. Okay. And if it belongs to your kids and you want to move it into your SMSF, or if it belongs to your parents and you want to move it into your SMSF, you also can't do that. So you can't acquire many types of assets from related parties. The ones you can acquire from related parties are things where it's very difficult to manipulate the value, is probably the easiest way of putting it. So direct equities, you can do that. Commercial property, again, special consideration for commercial property, and while widely held unit trusts, which generally mean managed funds. So these restrictions on collectibles and personal use assets. The other thing is there are these arm's length requirements. So let me have a look at my next slide. Business real property. Okay, so we'll talk about this one now. commercial premises, so this is an asset that is used wholly and solely for the purpose of providing commercial income, right? So it's not an investment property. There'll be plenty of people who argue that, you know, this. I've got 20 investment properties and therefore it's a commercial arrangement or whatever it might be. Just generally assume it's an office block, a factory, a farm or something else, right? So in this scenario, these commercial premises can be leased to a related party of the fund. And they can be acquired from a related party of the fund, whether that is you as an individual, your business, whatever it might be. So, as I said, 55% of our business owners in Business Bank have an SMSF. When you see this, you can see why. Because they go, look, I've got this little factory, I'm paying $10,000 a month in rent. Why don't I use funds within my SMSF, so my super balance and my spouse's super balance, whatever it might be, to acquire that factory, and then that $10,000 a month gets paid to my super fund rather than to a third party. If I go back, though, to the final point here, there is this arm's length requirement, which means even if you can acquire it from a related party of the fund and lease it to a related party of the fund, it's got to be done at market rates. So you cannot do it at less than market rates because that would be depriving your super fund of a benefit. And you can't do it at more than market rates because then effectively you're trying to exceed the contribution caps is probably the easiest way of describing what could be happening in that situation. So benefits if you are looking to own commercial premises, and even if you are a business owner, that's not a problem for you. In fact, it can be very beneficial. Borrowing a super, so many people are interested in this. As I said, it's very, very different to borrowing to invest in your own name. It's not as simple as borrowing to invest in your own name. And it took a lot of people who were familiar with investment borrowings a while to get familiar with this. There are three major restrictions. One is you can only borrow to buy a single acquirable asset. It doesn't sound like it means a lot, but when I said you almost definitely can't do development, if you borrow to buy a block of land, the second you want to put something on top of that block of land, it's no longer the single acquirable asset you acquired. It's something else. If you buy a single block of land or a single dwelling and then you want to subdivide, it's no longer a single acquirable asset. If you buy a house, knock the back off it and put on a new couple of bedrooms, the ATO will also take the view that that's not the single acquirable asset that you bought, that you've now extended it and turned it into something different, and you can't use your borrowed funds to do that. Now, you can do all of those things once you've paid off the loan and you're using other money to do it. Most people can't afford it, right? So with super contribution limits being what they are and so on, they don't have enough in their super to be able to take on meaningful property development in the fund without borrowed money. So that's what we're saying. In most scenarios, property development's just too difficult in an SMSF, which is, you know, pretty much intentional on behalf of the regulator because it tends to be higher risk activity. And they don't want super to be a higher risk structure, right? It's supposed to be there for your retirement, reasonably conservative. If you can borrow to buy something, you get this single acquirable asset, that asset has to be held on trust until the loan is repaid. So it kind of has to be separate from the rest of the assets of your fund, and the way they make it separate is by putting a bare trust arrangement outside it. The reason for that is the lender only has recourse to the asset you've borrowed to acquire. So as a lender, we can only lend you the money to buy that thing. And in the event you default, we can only take that thing. We can't take any other assets of the fund, which is really important. So they were trying to be quite careful about allowing people to borrow. As you can see, almost everyone who uses these arrangements uses them for property because it works quite neatly. We do have an equity loan that works within this legislation. For equities, it's pretty tricky. So if you want to borrow to buy equities, it has to be shares of the same type, purchased on the same day at the same price. So it's got to be a neat little parcel, and it can be quite difficult to get any diversification unless you buy ETFs, for example, or LICs all on the same day at the same price. So as I said, we've got an arrangement which will allow people to do it, but it actually has multiple loans underneath it, because if you want to buy 10 different stocks, even if you buy them all on the same day, you've still got 10 separate loans. It's a bit tricky for a lot of people. So as you can see, most people have stayed away from equities, and the people we see do it tend to be high net worth investors who sort of have fairly sophisticated arrangements they're trying to put in place. So, who can't or shouldn't start an SMSF? Just a couple of ones here, mostly because every now and then people can come unstuck. Back to the question earlier, people who are about to get divorced, probably not good for you. Anyone under the age of 18 or under a legal disability is not permitted in their own capacity, but you can have a legal personal representative, so a power of attorney, act on your behalf. This is becoming increasingly problematic with an ageing population. So a lot of people who set up an SMSF when they're in their 50s and have perfect capacity and making really good decisions, when they're somewhat older and no longer have capacity, it's very important that you have arrangements in place to either get that money out and have it managed professionally by somebody else, or you have a power of attorney in place so someone else can start acting on their behalf. You can't become an SMSF trustee if you are disqualified, which means you've been convicted of an offence involving dishonesty and a few other bits and pieces. Undischarged bankrupts also can't. There's nothing more awkward than being in a presentation, so having someone list their criminal history and asking whether or not they can. We'll save that one for later if anyone's got that question. The final one is this central control test, right? Central residence and control. A super fund is governed by Australian legislation, pretty obviously, and so they do not permit anyone to run an SMSF from offshore on a permanent basis. So the test effectively says central management and control must reside in Australia. They will generally, and these are general statements because it's not hard and fast under the law, but generally if you're offshore for more than 2 years, they will take the view that central management and control no longer resides in Australia and therefore the fund needs to be wound up, or you need to put powers of attorney in place in Australia to make decisions on your behalf. Now, I would suggest, making the point that I made in the very first slide, that you're still responsible for everything that happens. You would probably wind up in that situation rather than handing over all your money to somebody who effectively under the law can do whatever they want. So I had some friends, I've had to be careful with this, I had some friends who said to me the other day, oh, we're thinking about setting up an SMSF. And I said, oh, great. Like, yeah, yeah. Weren't you guys going back to the UK in a couple of years? And they were like, yeah, yeah, not for you. No SMSF for you. It's not a good idea. It's not worth setting one up and then winding it up a couple of years later. It's expensive and difficult. I wouldn't recommend it. So a couple of things to consider if you are thinking of going down this path. So you've gone through all the information, you've thought about whether the benefits are worth it for you and so on. Corporate versus individual trustees, you do need to make a decision about who is the entity effectively managing the fund. Most people have individual trustees, which means it's just you and your partner in your own name. But you can have a corporate trustee. A shell company is generally the best idea, so a company that has no assets, it's just set up for the sole purpose of being a corporate trustee. The reason we and many other professionals recommend this is that, first of all, it's easier from a paperwork perspective because you don't have to change the name of the individuals if you're changing stuff. More importantly, it does provide you with a level of protection if anything goes wrong. Again, to the horror stories, a couple had an investment property in their SMSF. They had a contractor come in to do some work on that property. He fell and hurt his back very badly, and he sued the fund, its insurance. So they didn't have building insurance that covered this guy, and so he sued them in their personal capacity. Now, had they had a corporate trustee, he would only have been able to sue the corporate trustee, which would have had no assets, and they would have been protected in their own personal right. So that extra level of protection can be important. Incredibly rare, but for most people it's worth it. Certainly my husband and I, we have a corporate trustee. Death benefit nominations. I promise this is my last horror story, but it's a good reminder for anyone who's not been down this path. How many people in this room are aware that your super is not automatically an asset of your estate when you die? Okay, I'm getting quite a few hands, that's excellent. So when you die, the trustee of your super fund under the law has the right to pay your superannuation death benefit to one of a number of people specified under the law without any regard to what you've got in your will. Okay? Because it's a trust structure, it's governed differently. Those people include your spouse. So de facto spouse is included, same-sex spouse is included. Your children, so that is your minor children, adult children, stepchildren, adopted children, and so on. Any person you're in an interdependency relationship with, which was sort of an arrangement brought in to cover same-sex couples when that was necessary, but also can cover elderly people living together who provide for each other and that sort of stuff. Doesn't require a sexual relationship or anything like that. And any person who is a tax dependent on you, so they're financially dependent on you for tax reasons. They can do that. And if you have a look at the Superannuation Complaints Tribunal, which doesn't cover SMSFs, roughly half of their complaints are people objecting to the way the trustee has chosen to pay a death benefit. The biggest complaint is where the trustee has chosen to pay the death benefit to a spouse over the adult children, particularly where it is a new spouse and the adult children believe that they're entitled to an inheritance. And the Superannuation Complaints Tribunal say very openly in all of their paperwork, superannuation is not there to be paid in lieu of an inheritance, right? So their view is, back to the sole purpose test and the ancillary purpose, to provide for members in the event of, dependents in the event of the member's death, we will pay benefits to those people who would have been living with you in your retirement, which is hopefully not your adult kid, hopefully not. Generally, it's a bit of a giggle with that one. We're in Sydney, right? It always includes your adult kids. It includes your spouse. And it doesn't matter how new that spouse is. If you got married 3 days ago, that person is your spouse under the law. If they've been living with you for 2 years, they're probably your spouse under the law. It includes any minor children, so children under the age of 18. And so the situation, and includes stepchildren under the age of 18. So split families, this becomes a massive problem. Now, in a self-managed super fund, you don't have this issue of an independent trustee looking at the law and then paying to individuals they don't know. You have the issue of someone you know, paying as they see fit. So the horror story that everyone loves to use, but it is a true story and it is used all the time as an example of what can happen. So dad is the sole trustee of a self-managed super fund because mum has passed away. He has two children, son and a daughter. He brings in the daughter as a secondary trustee because he can't be the only trustee and the only member. You have to have two trustees or a corporate trustee if there's a single member fund. So he brings in the daughter, says to her, when I die, obviously you and your brother will share everything equally. Yep, good dad, nice to know, thanks very much. Dad dies. Daughter brings in her husband as the other trustee and pays all of the benefits to herself. He took her to court, the brother. The court said, oh, that sucks, that's really bad. Unfortunately, under the law, there is nothing we can do. So they awarded costs against the super fund as their way of penalising her, but that was the only thing the court could do. She got all of the subsequent benefits. The one way you can avoid that situation is with a binding death benefit nomination. So two things you can do. One is make a binding death benefit nomination to your estate and then your will deals with everything. So that's one way. That's quite easy. Or you make a binding nomination to pay to one of those people who is specified as a dependent under the legislation or a combination of. This stuff is not that hard to do. A good lawyer can do it. There are pro forma documents on the internet you can get for $20, right? So it is not impossible to do. You just need to make sure you do it and you get it done properly. The other horror stories are usually where people have not got their paperwork in order, they didn't get it witnessed appropriately and so on. It needs to be witnessed just like a will. So it's not just I wrote it down and I'm happy now. Shall I leave that one now? Is everyone terrified and going home to fill out some paperwork? What should I call my fund? You do have to choose a name for it. Our fund is called the Global Lux Lifestyle Fund because because I feel if I have to lock my money up for that long, I want to feel like it's aspirational and I get something good at the end. the ATO is going to come for us, right? And then finally, who do you appoint as an auditor? Who do you appoint as a tax agent and so on? Generally speaking, you want to have someone professional managing those components for you. Ensuring you get the right person is really important. There are a lot of groups out there who will tell you now we do everything for you from a compliance perspective and so on. Generally, it's retrospective, right? So you get the special treatment at the end of the year, which means if you've made a mistake throughout the year, you've still made a mistake. So think about the kind of work you want someone to do for you and then set up the arrangement about around that arrangement rather than going, oh, it sounds like they do everything, I'll go with that. If anyone is thinking about setting up an SMSF, we do have an offer and it's not live just yet, so give us your details and we'll email it to you. Coming up, I think this week, I can't see Rach from here, she'll confirm for me. I think it's this week, definitely after Easter, if not. So it has nothing to do with NAB. We don't manage self-managed super funds. We work with a group called Heffron, who are independently owned. We don't pay them, they don't pay us. They do mine, and I pay them full freight for it, so I actually believe in them as a group. And they just put a special deal together for this event. Things to think about. Cost, does it stack up? So, generally speaking, if you have less than a couple of $100,000, it's very hard to make an SMSF economically viable. It's not impossible, but it is hard. I do know someone who set up an SMSF with $100,000 because he believed he could generate returns from the wider variety of assets he could invest in that would more than compensate for the cost. But many other people, that's not going to work for them. Who to trust? Who do you go to? Just be aware that accountants used to do pretty much everything for SMSFs. They now, if they want to advise on the establishment of an SMSF, starting a pension, contributions and so on, they have to be licensed. So they have to become licensed like financial planners because superannuation is a financial product under the Corporations Act. Most accountants chose not to because the paperwork's an absolute nightmare. So that does mean that you may need to look for someone else to manage some of the things that your accountant previously managed for you. You can't, literally can't do it all yourself. You must have an independent auditor and a couple of other things. And finally, if you're thinking about setting up an SMSF and you are rolling over from a public offer fund, please consider any insurance benefits you currently have in your fund. They can be less expensive than what's available elsewhere, but what is much worse is if you currently have cover and then you roll your fund out so that cover ceases and you want to get cover somewhere else, you can hold insurance for an SMSF, that's fine, but you might need to get re-underwritten and they may have exclusions or it might be much more expensive or something. So losing insurance is the one thing that many people prefer. So what we did and many other people do is they maintain a small amount in a public offer fund to cover their insurance and then they'll set up an SMSF somewhere else rather than lose what they have there. That is the offer that I mentioned, but it doesn't have the actual offer on it, so just loosely think about that with some special bits on it. And finally, we have a podcast that we've been doing for 3 or 4 months now, which I just absolutely love. It gives me an opportunity to talk to some really awesome people about some really awesome things. So if you're interested in signing up for that, we would love to hear from you. It's called Your Wealth. You can find it on iTunes or you can come to our website. Mm-hmm.